left to fend for myself. You heard with rapt attention a very smooth flow of words, enriched with English vocabulary. It sounded music to my ears. What a wonderful narration by Dr. Shilpa Khatri Babu. Affectionately, I call her my daughter. I killed and loved her a lot, but then I schooled her as well if she goes wrong anywhere. Notwithstanding that she is a very, very senior professor in her own right. The chairman of the executive council, Professor J.L. Gupta, who represents wisdom and foresight. He's a thinker, a philosopher, and a guide. A person who dwells deep, comes out with the freshest ideas of doing a turnaround in system of education. He has grappled with many problems, as was suggested earlier by Dr. Shilpa Khatri Babu. Professor J.L. Gupta has had the distinction of being the principal of Shriram College of Commerce for 9 years. And besides heading Shriram College of Commerce for 9 years, which is considered to be one of the most prestigious colleges for imparting education in commerce subjects. And remember, the entire infrastructure, including its auditorium and the classrooms, have been redone under his stewardship, and it's all contributed by the alumnus. The alumnus have contributed to making a beautiful auditorium, a well-stocked library, as rich as the central library of the university. I've seen, of course, bigger libraries in the IIMs. I see lakhs of books stocked there. And the students are also equally keen in reading those books. Reading those books is fast vanishing. Reading habits are fast vanishing. With the new JIGMOs coming so handy before you, you have got the tablet before you, you have got the smartphones, you have got the Google uncle to help and assist you, you'll Google it out. Access to information is fabulous. It arms you with new information, with new knowledge. But sometimes what the internet cannot tell you, repositories of knowledge like Professor J.L. Gupta can give you the key for all solutions which you have not been able to unlock, not been able to unravel the mystery. You are coming fresh from the schools. You are in your teens and just yet to grow. And grow exponentially. And the growth has to be a very systematic growth. It cannot be haphazard growth. This morning I was to a very eminent neurosurgeon to take his advice on a patient which has a malignant growth in the parietal region of the brain. And he said there are 60% chances of survival of this patient. Remember, if you grow haphazardously, if you are not following any system, we might have to resort to operating procedures which the learning faculty will deploy, because then they will be left to no option except to subject you to a painful surgery. But why is it being done? Do you know that there are two kinds of wounds? How many of you know that there are two kinds of wounds? Any one of you here in the audience can tell me there are two kinds of wounds? None of you may be able to tell because you come from commerce background or the humanities background and you may not be aware of there are two wounds. One is called the surgical wound. Remember the last man laughing. Are you laughing at me? Then you better come here and ask you a few questions. The gentleman inspects little chubby. What makes you smile or laugh at me? I'd ask you the reason. Why do you want to laugh? You must have reasons to laugh at me, right? Am I looking very shabby? Doesn't matter. For a few minutes you will have to suffer me. I was telling you there are two kinds of wounds. One is called a stab wound, when somebody stabs somebody and one bleeds to death. It's called a stab wound. When out of rivalry, out of vengeance, out of animosity, somebody stabs somebody, it's a stab wound. But there's another wound called a surgical wound. When is this surgical wound inflicted? A surgical wound is inspired by a sense of deep compassion. A surgeon has never been charged under section 304A, which is death caused by negligence, because the surgeon has done it with the intent to relieve you of the agony and the pain. So there are two kinds of wounds, one is surgical wound and there is a stab wound. In what context am I talking this is that the faculty might have to resort to some surgical procedures if you don't behave yourself, if you don't have the right conduct, if you don't have a sense of duty, if you don't have a sense of responsibility, and if you don't want to, if you stop to grow, if you don't want to evolve, in spite of all teaching aids available to you, every little bit of infrastructure being put to use, you know, put at your disposal, having been armed with the best of infrastructure, with the best of books in the library, with the best of faculty members, they want to reach out to you, they want to help you. But if you stubbornly refuse to listen to them, then maybe they inflict on you the surgical wound. Maybe some punitive measures are taken. But those punitive measures again are driven by a sense of compassion. They are more reformatory in nature than inflicting punishment on you. Remember this. Here you have to grow. And we want you to grow and grow enormously. I don't want you to grow haphazardly so that you become one such growth which needs to be surgically removed. So remember my children, when you come to WIPS, you need to remember three things. The right conduct. We will be observing your conduct whether you are having an ideal conduct or not. Or we are here to chisel you, polish you, and we normally do what we do here in WIPS is to chisel a raw diamond and to polish it so that it fetches a higher premium in the market. Your market value, you want to add value to yourself. You are coming raw from school, you don't know what you are supposed to be doing. You will have a complete identity crisis. One fine day somebody is going to ask you who you are, gentlemen. I may ask you even now as to what was the background in which you chose WIPS as your institution. I won't take you sit down. You are a teacher and you need not stand to discipline them. The discipline has to come from within you, right? You need to learn to discipline yourself. I know you have a tendency to be indisciplined because maybe in school you didn't get good teachers. But here each teacher has a moral authority and you will have to obey that authority. You will have to recognize that authority. Or else you have zero tolerance for rowdyism, for not being lawful, for not being orderly, systematic. You need to discipline yourself, discipline the faculties of your mind. Discipline is just not marching in a column. I don't want a column march here. We like to give you freedom, but then you have to remain disciplined. Wherever you go, in whatever walk of life you go, you must remain disciplined. Discipline will add value to you. You must always have the right conduct. Never ever should you do anything which doesn't have the sanction of the society, because the society doesn't permit. Our social customs won't permit. Become an asset and not a liability, either to your parents or to the institution. Must you make your institution feel proud of you and your attainments, your achievements. I extend to you a very hearty welcome and I thank your parents for their having to reduce faith in the competence and qualities that we possess, the values that we possess, the values that we represent. And we are virtually engaged in that mission of man-making, character building. Remember, this human anatomy is very different and the human mind is very complex. You may look like a normal boy and a normal girl, but you must be, you may be a very complex human being. We will try to make you a responsible citizen of this nation. The responsibility has to dawn on you. There has to be a set of realization that, yes, here I need to realize my responsibilities, both to the society as well as to the nation, and to my parents and the home and the relatives and friends and so on and so forth. And first you have to do service to yourself. Don't render this service to yourself by not being attentive in the class. Class is one part. The rest of it has all to be done by you. You have to develop a habit of self-study. उसको हम लोग हिंदी में बोलते थे स्वाध्याय करो, स्वयं अध्ययन करना, अपने हाथ में किताब खुद लेके चलना। कोई सिखाएगा नहीं घर में, जिसने किया है वो कामयाब हो गया। You have to cultivate habit of self-study all by yourself without being prodded by your parents or without being cajoled by your teachers. No cajoling, no coaxing, nothing, no chiding you. You are all affectionate children. We like to shower all your affection on you. We like to care for you. But we will care for you as long as you have a sense of responsibility. And I do it myself. I advise you as well to follow this practice if you can. Some of you, how many of you maintain your personal diary? How many of you maintain your personal diary? I want to ask. Have you started maintaining your personal diary? Just to scribble a few notes, whatever you have done during the daytime, during those boys who used to be scouts and guides, they used to maintain a diary in which they used to write one good deed a day, and that deed used to be recorded in that notebook. Those used to be good times when you had this, you know, scouts and guides organization which was doing a human job. It was nothing but doing stock taking of yourself. You write down how many hours have you studied, for how long have you recreated yourself, and what was the nature of that recreation or entertainment. We are not stopping you from entertaining yourself. But are you entertaining yourself on a ennobling creative thing, or you are just brooding and spending your time statistically on things which don't inspire your life, which don't enrich your life. So you have to very carefully plan your day, and you must know how to do your time management. Time management is now the buzzword. Time management. We don't know how to manage time. Morning we'll get up late, then we'll brush up and get ready and run fast on the road with all the anxiety running in our blood, and we say, our hearts will start galloping, and we say, we are getting late and let's make it to the class. Some of you will learn to bump. By now you may not have been able to bump. Maybe the environment of an institution make you bump more often. But remember, all that bunking of classes will be at your cost. At your cost. Remember this thing. I do my own stock taking every day. What have I done since morning? I got up at 5 o'clock. I did my useful exercise to keep myself physically fit. I did my meditation to keep me mentally fit. Physically fit and mentally agile all the time. Be brilliant beings. Be people who are looked upon. Yes, they are people. They are the epitomes of success. They are success stories. Don't write the story of failure. Each day you should keep stock of yourself, and each evening you should do your stock taking. How well have I utilized my time? How well have I utilized my time? Have some time for introspection. Try and introspect in yourself as to what have I done something productive, useful? Has it that task been useful to me and to my peers and to my neighbors and to the society and to my parents, whom I owe a special gratitude, who are bearing the whole cost of their education? What have I done? Have I added value to myself? Remember, education is the tool to empower yourself. If you educate yourself, if you keep your faculties absolutely well tuned to the classroom and to the activities outside, there may be activity learning, then activity based learning also. So please don't learn to waste time. Utilize time. Utilize time and maintain a stock of it. Do stock taking each evening. How every minute has been spent by me? Who secured 90% in this audience? I want to ask that. Oh, there are many who secured more than 90%. It's a very encouraging thing. All right, you gentlemen, you stand up and tell me, why is the television screen called as an idiot box? You come here, you better learn one, because you're speaking so. Your speech is very, very good, but I want to hear it louder. Anything good should be shared by all.
So for some people, it is said to be an idiot box television, but if we utilize it properly, then it may be of some utilization.
No, that's not the right answer. Anybody with 90% plus may stand up now. Why is a television called an idiot box?
Because it wastes time.
It doesn't waste your time, as long as you don't sit right in front of the box. The box only wastes your time as long as you are sitting in front of the box. Refuse, don't do that. Why do you blame the box?
Maybe because it takes us away from the real life and makes us live in a virtual life.
That can be one, but the right answer I'm still not getting. You want to answer? No, yes, that lady wants to answer. You come here to answer. Let everyone know the right answer.
So it's because something which makes you an idiot. It's something which makes you an idiot.
Good, good. I'm proud of you. Okay. Yes, tell me. Tell from here.
It's something which makes you an idiot. Because it's you who is calling your time, it's no one else.
Oh, this is nearly correct answer. It's a near correct answer. Still not correct answer. Should I tell you? Why is it called an idiot box? It is called an idiot box because it makes the idiot out of you. Why? Because the entertainers who have created their program have made their money. Those who participate in even serial, there are actors, you know. There are characters in that. Interesting characters. They create good entertainment for you. And you get glued to that box. Entertain yourself at the cost of your time. So the entertainers are gone. They have created a particular program. The newscaster has already telecasted the news. Then you start deliberating on the, you start doing analysis of the news, or you start doing analysis of a particular serial. And the real gainers are those who have created the programs, and not the one who are being entertained on the program. Are you getting the real meaning of the idiot? An idiot is he or she who wastes time aimlessly without having to gain anything out of it. The best inspiration you can get from your teachers, the best inspiration you can get from your neighbor who must have done exemplary job, must have excelled, must have been qualified for a civil service, may have been a good scientist, maybe a good lawyer, or maybe a good manager. Those are examples that you need to emulate. And not the ones, I mean, what you see on the idiot box. You really waste your time and gaining nothing. You are gaining nothing. I wish you had participated in those programs. I wish you had created those programs. I wish you had learned the production and made some programs to entertain others and made a good amount of money out of those creative programs. So most of the time, we behave like idiots. And idiots are those, let me tell you again, in the medical terminology, if you find somebody laughing without a reason, the object is not required. You look at sometimes at the idiot box, sometimes you smile, sometimes you have your emotions going high, and sometimes you become sad because some tragedy has happened, action movie is going on, somebody is bashed, and you become, you know, your mood swing with that. Now, who's handling whom? Are you the master of yourself, or is it the idiot box which is making you your mood swing up and down? And you don't care. You're unmindful of the time being spent, the time being invested. You could have invested this whole time in studying, in gaining something meaningful, in your career advancement. There's so much of plethora of information that you need to get, and you will only get when you get access to different kinds of resources. Like, we are connected with the British Council Library, we are connected with the American Library, and we have a lot of good stock of very well written books from very well celebrated authors. Have access to that information. Besides your classrooms, you need to go home, do your self-study, and remember, the jigmos are nothing but crippling the younger generation in so many manners. The social networking sites are doing the greatest harm. There was an organizational behavior of HR. We had an HR conclave here. And the fellow told, the smartphone is nothing but a curse to the younger generation. Being connected is good, but remaining connected for wrong reasons, which waste your time, precious time, is not at all good. So you need to introspect, analyze, critically think about it, critical thinking, spirit of inquiry. These are basics of a learner. You must learn to critically analyze. And you must always have a spirit of inquiry as to what next. What next can I get? What next knowledge can I acquire? What are the ways and means to get to the best of information so that I get some recognition? Because finally, you are here to get recognized. Either as commerce graduate or you want to be in business administration, but you are looking for some identification. Some identity. And that identity you will get only after you have excelled in the field of learning. It's the constant process of learning that I want to appeal to you that please remain attentive all through the class. Don't make judgments about teachers, good or bad. I've seen students gossiping, oh, that great teacher, she's no good. No, let me tell you, ladies and gentlemen, I have yet to find a teacher who has been bad. I always found a teacher who had their intrinsic qualities and they have grown so well that they have helped others also grow. Because the objective, the objective of the teacher is to see that the people being taught by them, they grow. Intellectually they grow, and it's not only the intellectual growth, but it's also your spiritual growth. Your emotional well-being, you should be emotionally balanced. And he will try to bring all the three, your intelligent quotient, your emotional quotient, and your spiritual quotient also. SQ is very important now. If you don't remain in touch with the live wire, remember, you'll be out of form. How many of you would like to stay out of form? Out of form. Will you like to be out of form? None of you will like to be out of form. And how do you stay in form? When you remain in constant touch with the flow of knowledge. When you refresh your thoughts, refreshing thoughts come to you. You entertain the freshest of ideas, freshest of theories. And you discover yourself that now you are evolving. Evolution, the process of evolution has begun within. You are somebody who was not till yesterday or till a year ago. Now you have grown intellectually. Emotionally you have become more stable. Spiritually you have grown. You have developed greater wisdom. That greater wisdom will come to you after your spiritual quotient is rich. You must always have an ideal in life. You must have some role model in life. And that role model should be always kept. That they are the ones who have inspired my life. And remember, one day you will so become so enriched, so valuable, people will seek after you. People who seek after chair has often eluded those people. Chair has eluded those people who seek after chair. Remember, if you are looking for a cushy chair after you are done your BCom honors and your BBA, no, it will elude you. But chair will chase you if you enable yourself, if you equip yourself with the right kind of knowledge. And the right kind of knowledge, the repositories of that knowledge, the repositories of that wisdom is the people who will be teaching you. Give them the highest respect and automatically you will get respect, you will get affection, and that affection will come in the form of blessings. Those blessings you should invoke. When you come to this institute, invoke those blessings of these teachers who are repositories of knowledge and wisdom. Your life will become blessed. Otherwise, your life will get cursed. I am glad to announce here that our journalism student has topped in the entire university amongst all the self-financing institutions. Which boy has graduated from the university with exemplary performance, securing 93% marks? Simply for having 93 marks and 92% marks in first graduation. There's another one who has won in the MCRC, Jamio. He is Akshay Chopra. He has done his master's and is again top the Jamia Millia University also. In the master's program also, our student has topped. In the law, we have topped again. This is the fourth consecutive year that Vips has got gold medal in the law stream, LLB. We have 37 students who have qualified the judicial services examination. They are judges in different states, stretching from Gujarat to Himachal and to the south, to Tamil Nadu and to Kerala. Everywhere you have a judge presiding over the court who belongs to Vips. Vips has this very rich legacy. We can justly feel proud of the legacy. But remember, you are a part of the history. You have to create a new history. You have to create new records. You have to create new records. Who is that sports person who has had the biggest juvenile throw? Javelin throw, yes. You, Tim? You have got a leading. What's the throw like? How many meters? He has broken the world record. Juvenile throw, yes. Recorded a new record. He has broken the world record and the Olympic record also. So there's always a scope for improvement. This tells us there's always a scope for improvement. We have to go from truth to higher truth. We don't need to stagnate, say, no, it's enough. I need to rest on my laurels now. I've done my graduation. Not enough. Need to do a post-graduation. Need to do research. Need to find more relevance in greater knowledge. Why not? People will only respect you and honor you if you have got the relevant knowledge, because knowledge also becomes stale. So you have to keep refreshing your knowledge. Don't sell anything which is basi roti khandi kar. Nahi na. Basi roti aadmi na. ये ही बासी रोटी है जो बासी जो तुम्हारे पास है ना ज्ञान ये इसको हमेशा तरोताजा रखो. Let the freshest of knowledge flow. Keep your minds open and eyes wide open and ears wide open. So the best of ideas come, the best of people, repositories of knowledge, they give you, dispense you with the worldly wisdom and they give you an edge. You will not be average students, let me tell you. You are a blessed people. Because Swamiji has said, set up one goal, man-making. A man becomes an engineer, a man becomes a doctor. But remember what happens, I see most of the time, an engineer makes a bridge and the bridge collapses. What went wrong? He had the engineering principles in place. He knew the weight-bearing capacity of each of the pillars that he has put underneath the bridge. But he lacked in human qualities, in human values. Divide of human values, you are no man. You don't qualify to be man. So Swamiji has stressed upon man-making, character-building, and nation-building. Remember, the three motives, the three goals that we need to accomplish. Each one of you has to do it. And we have put up these mottos everywhere, displayed it in different places, including library and public places. If you go, man-making, be the right kind of man. Never be a man who is defamed or has done something which the society doesn't permit. Become good human beings. If you are a good human being, if you have compassion at the bottom of your heart, remember, you will grow. The moment you stop being compassionate, you will stop growing. So be good human beings, you will become good doctors. You will become good engineers. You will become good technocrats. You will become good commerce graduates. You will become good business administrators. Man, the basic unit, the man has to be good. You have to be all goodness. Nothing wicked should come to you. No wicked thoughts you need to entertain on the surface of your mind. Always entertain noble thoughts, uplifting thoughts. That takes you up. That takes you through towards evolution, towards change, towards growth. So remember this. You need to be good human beings. You need to have your strength of character. I can tell you one of these most interesting stories when Swami Vivekananda had gone to Kashmir and he delivered his first lecture there in the Kashmir University. I'm not talking of these turbulent days when there's a lot of violence. A lot of people are asking for the armed forces, you know, the Special Power Act. But there were times when Kashmir was all peace. It was all serene, it was all heavens. Swamiji spoke there. And more of the ladies, they came around Swamiji, appreciated him for the impeccable speech that he delivered, appreciated him for his oratory and for the depth of knowledge. And the boys, notorious like you, they said, Swamiji, you're all the time surrounded by ladies and not by the men. He said, I'm telling you one secret. And this secret also you should remember. He said, do you know why they throng around me? Because I got a very precious jewel. I got a very precious jewel which I am in possession of. It is costlier than Kohinoor. Have you heard of Kohinoor diamond? The Swamiji had a jewel which was more precious than the diamond, than the Kohinoor. And he kept it close to his own self. And then many of you became very curious, saying, please show us as well. Why do you show it to the ladies only? Why not to the man? Pop. We are equally keen seeing the jewel, precious jewel. He said, my dear friends, that precious jewel is my strength of character. The day I lose my character, these very ladies who are coming, who throng me, my meetings are thronged by ladies only because I am a man of character. The day I don't have the jewel of character, these same very ladies will kick me on my face. This was Swamiji's statement. Moment you become characterless, moment you have lost your character, the same very ladies who respect me, who behold me, who hold me in veneration and high regards, those very ladies will kick me on my face the day I lose my character. Then I have my greatest strength is character. The human character has to be upheld. Above all values is the strength of character. Remember this. So man-making, character building and nation building. Of course, this nation needs people like you, young men and women like you, those who have strength of character. Those who will not compromise on their integrity. Those who will always uphold their integrity. Those who will always work for the welfare of the society, upliftment of the society. Those who are always ready to reach out to the have-nots, to help them in whatever manner you can, you will grow. You will grow exponentially, I tell you, and your growth will be enormous. And one day, you will get recognized as one of the finest persons. You will get recognition. Maybe some of you become Nobel laureates. If you really devote your time to self-study, as I told you, 4 to 5 hours of self-study, do attend the classes, but thereafter you can follow my advice of 4 to 5 years of self-study. Just habit you cultivate. I am not asking you to read the textbooks. Remember, I am asking you to read literature or any other thing. You can learn languages, you can learn anything. But remember, this cultivation of a habit of 4 to 5 hours of self-study is very, very essential for people who want to grow. And people who don't want to grow, they may just shut their books, keep home, and let their dust pile over them. We may have many more sessions, but I want to tell you a few things. And I'm giving the last talisman. You can press this and try this. And this will be my last, okay? I'll not bore you thereafter, because all of you must be tired of me. And there came an old man with grey hairs, and he made us sit for so many hours and didn't give any piece of wisdom. What I'm telling you is, you need to jot down and take it down seriously. I've told it to teachers, of course, each one of our teachers knows that. How many of you will note down this? How many of you are serious about it? Have your notebooks? Do you have pens to scribble? And then take the feedback also. All those who want to learn good habits, I'm going to give a talisman. No, it will not. It is very small, but very useful. It will be very fruitful in life. And remember this, it was prescribed by a doctor. It is a scientifically proven formula for you, which will lead you to growth. An exponential growth. An all-round growth. All those who want to grow in terms of knowledge, in terms of wisdom, and in terms of character, they will note down this. And this is scientifically proven in the world community, and it has been accepted world over, that this has science behind it. It can be tested and tried. Sow a thought. Sow. S-O-W. Sow. Sowing is a sowing season, you know. People, you know, farmers will sow their fields now. They sow a seed, you know, the different kinds of that kind of, you know, plant will be raised. Sow a thought and reap an action. Write in one sentence, sow a thought, reap an action. There will never ever be an occasion when you are not sown a thought and it has not reaped an action. No thought can remain in your mind without having to result in an action. So I thought, you need to ponder over it. I mean, just not dismiss it straight away. Go home, think about it, as to what thought did I implant in my mind. Whether it is a noble thought or a wicked thought, they will make you do the same thing. So I thought, reap an action. This is a fundamental principle, proven the world over. Saw an action. Saw, S-O-W, saw an action and reap a habit. Do an act time and over again, it will become your habit, right? Whatever you do, that will become your habit. It doesn't require any testing. It has been verified and tested the world over by the scientific community. I'm not telling my own, okay? It's not my experiment. Sow a thought, reap an action. Every thought is going to result in action. This is proven fact. Sow a thought, reap an action. Sow an action, reap a habit. Then you start going to a place, a place of worship, and that you will get in habit of going to the temple time and over again. Why not? You will automatically get pulled towards, you know, you will start gravitating towards a temple or a place of worship. Maybe any, it may be Gurdwara or a mosque or anything. But you start ahead, going ahead, start marching ahead. So I thought, reap an action. Sow an action, reap a habit. And sow a habit, reap a character. Sow a thought, reap an action. Sow an action, reap a habit. Sow a habit, reap a character. By repetitively going to a place, some people go to the bars, some people go for the dancing clubs, some people start going there, they are known by what act they are doing, right? So that will become a habit, you will develop that habit. One wicked thought implanted here is bound to make you act wickedly. And one noble thought, one entertaining thought, one ennobling thought, uplifting thought is going to lift you up. You are not going to live at a subhuman existence level. You will be raised to glory. All of you can be raised to glory. But why did you practice this? So I thought, deeper action. Ponder over it when you go home and try it. And try to implant a thought and then try to stop yourself from acting in accordance with the thought. So I thought, deeper action. So an action, deeper habit. So a habit, deeper character. And it goes beyond to say, so a character, deeper destiny. You are the architect of your own destiny. Therefore, your destiny cannot be otherwise. Your destiny has to be in tune with your character. If you are a bad character, you are bound to doom and get destroyed by whatever forces those may be. Try this, and as some of you who try this in actual life, in your virtual life, I tell you, it's going to be a very, very rewarding experience, because you will learn how to put your shutters down when a wicked thought is coming. When the wickedness of thought is coming, because it will weaken you. It's not going to give you strength. It will weaken, that thought will weaken you. So a thought, reap an action. So an action, reap a habit. So a habit, reap a character. And so a character, you will reap a destiny. All those who want to shape their destiny must practice this formula and must have a strong regulator like a sluice valve. You must know where to stop. And once you have known this, that this is the place where I need to stop, many of you should learn to say no more often than yes. Because by saying yes, you have a degree of commitment. Many times, many proposals will come your way, many temptations will come your way, and if you don't learn to say no, you are into a trap which will be killing. So I'll rest my address here by assuring you, my children, my ladies and gentlemen, the ladies and gentlemen sitting here, we'll try to give our very best to you. And we want to see you at the pinnacle of your career. But you too have to cooperate with us in attending your classes, in being present, in being attentive, in being obedient, and by being very, very faithful people. I can assure you that you will take it to the new heights. Thank you very much.